Hello guys, this is Dr. Issa, podiatry resident at Westchester General Hospital. I will be putting some lectures for students and residents on YouTube, and this is my very first lecture. Today we will cover the very basic principles of screw fixation. The targeted audience of this lecture is any podiatry student in the third or fourth year, any MD or DO students that are interested in orthopedics. It's also for orthopedic and foot and ankle surgery residents as well. I used three sources for my presentation. The first one is the Johnson & Johnson Institute website, which provides a lot of free material that you can watch, and you can also earn credit that you can use to purchase textbooks from the organization. I also use the basic podiatry course, the internal fixation of foot and ankle by the Podiatry Institute, in addition to the AO principles of fracture management by the AO organization. First, let's start with a few questions. The first question is, if you have a measurement of a certain number, what screw size you will ask your screw-up tech to give you? So if you measure 16 millimeter and you need a non-self-tapping screw, what number you will ask for? A 14, a 16, or an 18 millimeter? And if you measure 16 millimeter again and you have self-tapping screw, would that make a difference in the length of the screw that you need? Next is, if you have if you measure 15 millimeter and you need to place a cortical screw versus a cancel screw, are you going to ask for a 14 millimeter or a 16 millimeter screw? The next set of questions we have: what is a pre-drill? What's a T-sleeve technique? What's compromised compression technique? Why do we countersink? And which one comes first? Do we measure first or we tap first? Do we measure first or countersink first? Do we overdrill or underdrill first? If you do not know the answer to any of these questions, or if you're not sure, then it will be a good idea to watch the rest of the lecture. The one and only objective of this lecture is proper screw choice and placement. It's a long lecture, so we'll divide it into multiple parts. First, let's start with the introduction. AO principles of fracture management are four. First, anatomical reduction, meaning that you need to place the bones back into the original alignment. You don't want any rotation or angulation or elongation or shortening, but at the same time, articular reduction is much more important than the fracture reduction. So as long as you have articular surface together, you're good. Next is stable fixation. Stable fixation is not equal to rigid fixation. Stable fixation could be flexible, could be rigid, depending on the scenario that you deal with. Both are correct and in the correct situation. We'll talk about this more during the lecture. Number three is preservation of blood supply. I see a lot of people, they remove the periosteum, they want to place the plate directly on the bone. That is not correct. This actually causes more damage and harm to the patient than benefit. You need to preserve the blood supply as much as possible, which means that you could use limited contact plates, and also you should dissect as least as possible. Finally is early and active mobilization. Get the patient out of the boot or the posterior splint as fast as possible. Let the patient does early range of motion. That helps with the fracture healing and also helps maintain a normal range of motion, and also decreases the chances that the patient will get complex regional pain syndrome or any other kinds of pathological pain. Now, is there a difference? Is there a difference between placing two pieces of wood together and placing two pieces of bone together? Of course there's a difference. Difference is the following: blood supply. The bone needs to heal, the bone needs to be independent of the fixation devices that you apply to. So at a certain point, the bone needs to heal and get stronger. So you need to reserve as much blood supply as possible. Wood is different because you do not need to remove the screws from the wood, and the wood will not heal. I see a lot of people treat fractured bone the same way that they would fix two pieces of wood together. What could compromise blood supply to the bone? Well, and the accident itself, the displacement of the fracture fragments, compromise the periosteal and endosteal blood vessels as well. The transportation, if the fracture is not stabilized, that will add to the harm to the blood supply. The surgical approach that does not respect soft tissue, and this is something that we could work on to decrease the damage of the blood supply. The implants that will result in periosteal stripping will also damage the blood supply. And finally, in children, an increase in the intra-articular pressure will not be tolerated. The two points that we can really work on to decrease the blood supply is the surgical approach and the implant placement. Always irrigate drill hole generously with normal saline. That will minimize the thermal necrosis and at the same time will flush away the bone debris to maintain the cutting speed of your drill. Always use a drill guide that will protect your soft tissue, and at the same time, if you are applying your drill guide over the plate, that will also protect the plate and help you get control over the direction of the drilling. Rigid versus flexible fixation, primary versus secondary bone healing, which one is better? There's no one that is better. There is the device that you could use for a specific scenario that's perfect for it. Flexible fixation devices include casting, external fixation, IM nail, and bridge plating. These ones do not keep the bone in a rigid position. These allow the bone to have micro motion. If you have a micro motion, this means that you will heal by secondary bone healing. What does that mean? This means that you will have a soft callus, then you will have a hard callus, then the bone will heal with organization. That's your flexible fixation heals with secondary bone healing because you have micro motion. Now the rigid fixation occurs when you use multiple lag screws, compression plates, or locking plates, because these ones will have a very, very minimal or no micro motion at all. In this case, you're not going to have a soft callus. You will go directly to bone healing. Articular versus non-articular fractures, which one do we need to have rigid fixation for and which one we could have flexible fixation for? Well, flexible fixation is good if you have extra-articular fractures. These ones will allow you to get to heal by having micromotion. Micromotion gets you stronger bones because the bone kind of depends on itself overcome the load. Versus if you have an articular fracture you need to have a rigid fixation because rigid fixation will prevent any callus formation. You do not want to have any callus formation at the level of the joint. Otherwise, the patient will have arthritis. As we know, joints do not tolerate any step off. That's why rigid fixation for any articular fractures. Rigid fixation will not be the optimal fixation for the bone, but it will be the optimal fixation for the articular surface, because you do not want any micro motion to happen at this point. So if you see a callus formation, is this a good thing or a bad thing? Well, again, it depends on which fixation devices that you're using. If you use an IM nail, that provides you with flexible fixation. Hence, there's no problem. Callus formation basically means that the bone is healing. However, if you see a callus formation when you use a locking plate, that's a disaster. That's because this means that there is a micro motion where you're not supposed to have micro motion. If there's a micro motion, this means that the plate is not shielding the stress and the load from the bone, which means that the plate and the screws are all getting loose at the same time. So this is a catastrophic failure of your fixation device. So again, if you see a callus formation, with flexible fixation device, that is good because it means that the bone is healing with secondary bone healing. If you see a callus formation where you have a rigid fixation device, that is not good because this means that there is a micro motion and that primary bone healing will not occur. Now, diaphyseal versus metaphyseal fractures, which one heals faster? Well, metaphyseal fractures, they have a larger surface area. There's a bigger surface area in the metaphysis. There is a better blood supply in the metaphysis than the diaphysis. So any fractures that occur in the metaphysis will have higher chances of healing than fractures that occur in the diaphysis. We'll stop at this point and we can go to part 2. Thank you.